Now, the third topic is abdominal mass and role of ultrasound. As I said before, for many topics, there is no protocol put forth. So my aim is to put forth a protocol for this abdominal mass. So mass can be due to an antenatal scan. So an antenatal scan, they could have picked up a mass in the abdomen, so it may come for a scan. Or clinician may have felt a mass and or abdominal distension. Or a previous scan report would have said a mass. Or when you are doing scan for some clinical symptom, you pick up a mass. Now, this is a case of an antenatal scan reported as abnormal mass. And now you see a mass in the right adrenal area and color Doppler, there is flow. And that was removed, turned out to be a neuroblastoma. And more commoner one is an ovarian cyst antenatal scan. And now postnatally, you see that it is complicated and there is a lot of debris inside. So that is an ovarian cyst which is complicated. Now, role of ultrasound in a mass is confirmation of the mass and to know the organ of origin or, if not possible, a plane of origin and characterization of the mass, whether it is benign or malignant. And if it is malignant, extension of the mass and then complications due to the mass. Now, to know the organ of or plane of origin, these are the various signs described. We'll go one by one. Now, first one is the pattern recognition. So pattern recognition is once you are seeing any number of scans, and moment you do the scan, by the pattern, you are able to tell the diagnosis. So one example is the hydronephrosis. You see cystic mass in the area of the kidney. You see dilated calyces and the dilated pelvis. So you know that it is hydronephrosis. As opposed to a multicystic kidney, where you see multiple cysts of varying size, non-communicating, and you don't see any parenchyma. So that is multicystic kidney. When you see a mass with calcifications, you first vote for a teratoma. And if you see the pseudo kidney appearance, like here, you know that it is a bowel mass. And if you see a cyst and you see the gut signature in the wall, then you know that it is a duplication cyst. And in the woman, in the adnexa, if you see the echogenic mass characteristic of a cystic teratoma. So these are some examples of pattern recognition. The moment you see that, you know the diagnosis. Now here you see four images. And here you see a cyst, which is multiseptated, and it is, you see the with the transducer, it is compressible, so it is flaccid. And you see its effect on adjacent organs. So it does not produce any effect on the adjacent organs. It goes around and with acute angles. That means it does not respect tissue planes. And here you see the colon, and all around the colon you see a cyst. So this is typical appearance of retroperitoneal lymphangioma. So this is again pattern recognition. And now this is a 55-year-old man. There is a painful mass in the right iliac fossa. This is the appearance you get. So this is the convex probe. So many times you may not get features on the convex scan, but if you shift to the high frequency scan, you get the pattern recognition. What do you see here? You see multiple layers. So this is called the cut onion appearance. So cut onion appearance in the right iliac fossa, it is a pattern recognition diagnostic of mucinous cystadenoma of appendix because of temporal deposit of mucin. Next sign is called the intra-organ sign. That is the mass you see, but you see that it is well within the confines of an organ. So there is no doubt about the origin of the mass because it is within the organ. These are some examples, a cyst within the liver, multiseptated cyst within the liver, an echogenic mass in the liver, an angiomyolipoma in the kidney, a calculus in the urinary bladder, and a mass within the urinary bladder. So this is intra-organ sign. Next is phantom organ sign, where you see a large mass arises from a small organ, and as a result, the organ is not seen. So here you see right kidney. In the right adrenal area, you see a mass and you don't see the adrenal separately. So that is we diagnose adrenal mass. Now coming to the beak side. So how is it produced? Now this is the organ. You imagine that it is ovary. That is a mass arising from the ovary. It keeps on enlarging. So when it becomes much enlarged than the organ, the rest of the organ gets compressed and forms a beak over the mass. So this is called the beak sign. So if it is present, we know that the mass is arising from the organ. So that is the example, the ovary, and you see a large echopoa mass, and you see the compressed ovary with the beak sign on either side. So this is the beak sign confirming that mass is arising from the organ. Some other examples of beak sign in the kidney, multiple masses in the kidney, and you see the beak sign in all of them. So that is the beak sign showing that the mass is arising from the kidney. Now claw sign. So claw sign is multiple beak signs. So here you see the kidney and the mass, and I'll invert picture to see better, similar to the claw. So that is the kidney and that is the mass, and you see the claw sign, the beak on both sides. So that is the claw sign confirming that the mass is arising from the kidney. Now this is the reverse beak sign. Now you see the organ and the mass, but in between you see the groove, that is the reverse beak. So when you see this, suggests that the mass is not arising from the organ. They are close together, but not arising from the organ. So this is a ganglioneuroma of the retroperitoneum anterior to the kidney, and you see the reverse beak sign. Now here, to stress the reverse beak sign, I'll show in this example. This is a 2-month-old female infant, previous ultrasound focal mass of the left lobe of liver, hemangioendothelioma. MR scan reported as a thick-walled cystic lesion, segment 4, cori mesenchymal hamartoma. So referred for repeat ultrasound, you see the liver and you see the mass. So this is looks like a necrotic mass, and you see the reverse beak sign. So that means it is not arising from the liver. Again, another section, you see the reverse beak. There is the mass and the liver, which is compressed. So that is reverse beak sign. So it is extrahepatic. So what is it? Then you see is high frequency. You see the surface of the liver. There is a crater. This is the mass. This is the necrotic substance. And so that is an abscess. And you see the crater. So what has happened is a ruptured liver abscess with an extrahepatic collection. You see the wide gap in the diagnosis by using signs and using the high frequency scan, particularly in children. So it is not at all a tumor, it is just a ruptured liver abscess. Now another sign is embedded organ sign. Here what happens is an organ is embedded within the mass. So here there is a bowel loop which is embedded in a large mass, echopower mass. So this is a mesenteric lymph node mass of lymphoma embedding the loop of bowel. Here there is a mass around the kidney and embedding the kidney. This is a case of perinephric hematoma. Now this is central abdomen. You see a large septated cystic mass, but in the center you see gas filled bowel, and in the perpendicular to this section you see the multiseptated cystic mass, and you see a loop of bowel going through that. So you know, now you know the diagnosis. It is a mesenteric lymphangioma. You can see the real time. You see the whole mass moves, indicating that it is intra-abdominal and multiseptated, and you see the peristalsis in the bowel loop in the center. So this is embedded organ sign. This is mesenteric lymphangioma. Next sign is floating aorta sign. What is it? It is displacement of the abdominal aorta away from the vertebral column. So that is the aorta. It is displaced from the vertebral column. This happens only when there is retroperitoneal lymph node mass lifting up the aorta. So it is a sign of retroperitoneal lymph node mass. Then you diagnose mass based on the location and shape. So here you see cystic mass in the region of the gallbladder, in the gallbladder fossa, and you don't see the gallbladder separately, and it is pyriform, taking the shape of gallbladder. So it is dilated gallbladder. Now, this is a mass in the renal fossa. It has got the shape of the kidney, and so it is an enlarged kidney. Then we come to the sign of continuity. Now, here you see the transfer scan of the pancreas, portal vein. You see a cyst anterior to the portal vein. Cyst which is continuous with the common hepatic duct, confirming that it is a choledochal cyst. So, continuity confirms the diagnosis. Now, here you see a large cyst in the right flank, and you see the kidney, and you see a mild dilated renal pelvis, and there is a communication of the renal pelvis with its large cyst. So, this is what is the appearance. You see the kidney, you see the dilated calyces pelvis, which is communicating with a huge dilated, grossly dilated upper ureter. This is happens in a ureteric valve with cystic dilatation of the upper ureter. Differential diagnosis will be a retroperitoneal cyst. Now, to stressen the continuity sign, I will show you two examples, identical. Two children presenting a sprain abdomen. Both the cases, previous scan report said pseudocyst. Case 1 and case 2, you see the cyst. Now, in case 1, use the high frequency scan. You see the liver, gallbladder, you see the cyst, and you see the gut signature. So, that means it is a duplication cyst. But from where, you see the transverse colon here. So, the transverse colon and the wall of the transverse colon and wall of the cyst are continuous. So, continuity, sign of continuity says that it is a duplication cyst of the transverse colon. Whereas in the case 2, in the high frequency scan, you see the cyst, again gut signature, duplication cyst, but this is the stomach, and you see the wall of the stomach and wall of the cyst are continuity. So, it is a gastric duplication cyst. You can see how this has helped us to differentiate. Then tissue planes. So, parietal masses will be seen in the abdominal wall, as seen here, a lipoma and cysticercosis clearly within the abdominal wall. And when you have a doubt, a real time will show that the mass does not move with respiration, whereas intra-abdominal structures will move. Parietal structures will fail to move, confirming that it is a parietal mass. Whereas here there is a mass which is intra-abdominal, as evidenced by the respiratory movement. You see the nice movement shows that it is intra-abdominal. Then you can further characterize. And then another sign is sign of exclusion. So suppose, see here, this is a child with a coronal scan of the left flank. You see a mass here. So this mass in the region of the left adrenal. So what are all possible? It can be mass in the left adrenal area. And this is a transverse scan of the left flank. And this is a transverse scan of the, again, a transverse scan of the left flank at a little higher level. So it can be arising from the spleen, but you see the spleen normal. So it is not arising from the spleen. It is can arise from the kidney, but again you see the left kidney. So you see the mass is not arising from the left kidney. It can arise from the adrenal, but you see again the adrenal is normal. And it can arise from the tail of pancreas. Again, in this section, you see the tail of pancreas, which is normal. And stomach again looks normal in both the sections. So all the possible organs are excluded. That narrows down to the mass arising from the retroperitoneum. Okay, so this is by exclusion. Then effect of the mass. So here you see a mass in the mid-abdomen, and you see a dilated loop proximal to that, and you see the loop entering the mass. So by this you know that it is a small bowel mass with obstruction with a dilated loop proximal. Now here similarly hydronephrosis, and you see the dilated ureter and the mass. So this is a ureteric tumor producing obstruction and hydronephrosis. Effect on adjacent organs. So this is a young girl with a mass in the suprapubic region. And the sagittal scan shows the bladder normal, and posterior to the bladder, you see a large cyst. And a high frequency scan a little above shows that the cyst and the uterus anterior to it, and you see the cervix within the cyst, confirming that it is a hematocolpus. Another case, you see the hydrometrocolpus. So this effect confirms that it is hematocarpus. Now here you see in the mid-abdomen a multiseptated cyst. This is the left kidney showing hydronephrosis, and the cyst is compressing the ureter and producing hydronephrosis. So that confirms that it is a retroperitoneal lymphangioma compressing the ureter. Now next sign is feeding vessel sign or the fruit on the branch sign. Now here patient presenting with melena, you see mass above the urinary bladder and high frequency shows again the mass. So whether it is a mass or a fecal mass, you put on the color, you see a large vessel supplying the mass. So single vessel supplying the mass and branching. So this is the feeding vessel sign confirming that it is a polyp in the colon, colonic polyp. And this is also called the fruit on the branch. So that is the fruit on the branch. So that vessel is the stalk of the fruit. So that is helps us to diagnose the polyp. Then origin of the mass sorted out by color Doppler. You'll see some examples. Now this is a kidney and you see a mass and you see the reverse beak. So suggesting that the mass is not arising from the kidney. Again here reverse beak. But when you put on the color, you see the feeding vessel is from the renal artery. So it is arising from the kidney, but it is almost like a pedunculated exophytic mass from the kidney. Another mass in the left iliac fossa anterior to the psoas muscle, that is again longitudinal scan. But on color, you see it is supplied by a branch from the external iliac artery. So that confirms it cannot be from the intra-abdominal structure. So that narrows down to a retroperitoneal mass. Now here in the transverse scanner, you see a large irregular mass. And in color shows that the celiac artery is within the mass, diagnosis of celiac lymph node mass. Then another example, a mass in the region of the pancreas, the superior mesenteric vein is anterior. So if it is a pancreatic mass, then it should be, the superior mesenteric vein should be compressed. But in transverse scan, you see by the vessels, this is IVC, posterior to the mass, superior mesenteric vein, anterior to the mass. So in between the IVC and superior mesenteric vein is the uncinate process of the pancreas. So the mass is arising from the uncinate process of the pancreas. There is a large mass in the mid-abdomen. Color Doppler shows superior mesenteric artery coursing through it, making a diagnosis of mesenteric lymph node mass. Similarly, an echogenic mass in the mesentery as evidenced by superior mesenteric artery into mesenteric fibromatosis. Now there is a large mass in the right iliac fossa. And if you put color, you see the external iliac vessels are pushed anteriorly by the mass, making a diagnosis of a retroperitoneal mass, most likely lymph nodes. Now here again, kidney with a mass, the reverse beak sign, but on color Doppler, the flow is from the kidneys, so it is a renal mass. Now here, this is a newborn with a large mass in the region of the pancreas. So how to know the origin of the mass? First is the duodenum. You see confirmed by the fluid that it is duodenum. Second, the aorta and the IVC. So the mass is anterior to the aorta and IVC. And you see the superior mesenteric vein. So the mass is surrounded by duodenum, IVC, aorta and superior mesenteric vein. So it has to be in the head of pancreas and it is heterogeneous and the newborn. So it is a pancreaticoblastoma. Another case of mass and high frequency shows that it is related to a small bowel loop and it is continuous with the small bowel loop, wall, and color Doppler shows flow from the bowel loop, making it as a gist from the bowel. Now some maneuvers you can use to diagnose. Now this is the left lobe of liver. You see a mass. So it can be from the left lobe, it can be from the stomach, it can be from the spleen. And so if you see the stomach, there is a beak of the stomach. So it could be from the stomach. So you give oral fluid, you see the fluid moving, going all around the mass, inside of the mass, making a diagnosis of with the beak that it's a leiomyoma of the stomach. Similar mass, but here you see the stomach being posterior. So it can be from the left lobe of liver, but you see the beak here. So when you give fluid, you see that fluid flows all around the mass except this area. So making it is a polypoid mass from the anterior wall of the body of the stomach, and it is a gist. And this is a mass in the left hypochondrium. Stomach was seen separately, but you see gas inside the mass. So when you give oral fluid, the fluid goes into the mass, confirming that it is an exomorphatic mass of gist from the stomach. Now here, post ureteroscopy, there is a large cystic mass with hydronephrosis, and you see that there may be communication. So you press release with the color Doppler, you see flow away and flow towards across the breach. So in the ureter, so this is a trauma to the ureter with a urinoma. You have to seek a mass in these situations. Now here in a patient with hematuria, you see a clot. So close look at the kidney shows that there is a mass. And the bleeding PR, you see a mass here. And you see gas all around. So whether it is a fecal mass or polyp, you put on the color, you see flow inside making it a polyp. Bleeding PR, you see a mass here with a gut signature, whether it's mass or duplication or Meckel's. And a normal loop, it is aperistaltic. So you repeat the scan after 1 hour, it remains the same, making that it is abnormal and it is a Meckel's diverticulum. Now, morbillous vomiting, you have to look for the mass of hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. In bilious vomiting, you have to look for the valvulus, as seen here, the whirlpool sign of midgut malrotation and valvulus. And in red currant jelly with cry, you must suspect intussusception. So you see intussus. Now clinically, you suspect a mass, but you don't see a mass on ultrasound. Now here, this is the kidney, and you don't see a mass in the right flank. But now this is normal. You see the distance posterior to the kidney. This is normal. Here it is increased. So maybe you are missing, and you see gas there. So this gas is preventing visualization of the mass. So little scan with the tilt of the patient, you see that there is a large abscess with gas, which is prevented because of the gas shadowing. And a coronal scan makes out the abscess. So this is a posterior perinephric gas with abscess. This is a child with constipation and a mass in the suprapubic region. But in ultrasound, you see this can be gas in the dilated rectum. But in transverse scan, there was resistance felt for the transducer, and transverse scan shows a huge dilated rectum with resistance. So that is a fecalith. This is a 40-year-old woman, fullness and mass felt clinically, but you fail to see a mass. This is a very important situation, but there is resistance for the transducer. So when you observe, you see a rotatory movement indicating that there is a mass and mimicking bowels. So this is a cystic teratoma. And imagine if you have not reported this and the surgeon operates. Now mimicker for a mass. So here you see the urinary bladder. Posterior to that, you see a cystic mass. But this is due to reverberation artifact because of gas in the rectum. How to avoid? You repeat the scan after some time, or go to the laterally and do the section. And you can, another pointer is, you can see the distance. It will be equidistant, and the pelvis will end there. But you see the mass extending beyond the contentment of the pelvis. You must suspect a reverberation artifact. Now then we come to characterization. That is a cyst, solid, echogenic, heterogeneous, and high frequency is very useful. As seen here, you see the kidney, which was reported as solid and cystic mass in retroperitoneum. But here you see the beak sign showing that it is intrarenal, and the reverse beak sign that it is also extrarenal. It looks like abscess. So what has happened is there is an intrarenal abscess which is ruptured and produced a perinephric abscess. You see how much detail you get. And this is a mass in the left lobe of liver with high frequency. You see that it's typically hemangioma with enhancement. Renal mass, bilateral, high frequency shows that it is classically autosomal recessive polycystic kidney. It's a patient with acute pain, right iliac fossa. There is a large mass. We see that there is a tender mass of omentum, fat, ileum, and appendix, showing that it is an inflammatory mass of appendix. Now here there is a mass in the adrenal area, and you see the broken diaphragm sign because of the difference in speed of ultrasound, and that tells us that the mass contains fat, so the diagnosis becomes myelolipoma. Here there is necrotic mass with color flow, you so know that it is necrotic tumor. Now this is an ECOPO mass and with enhancement, so you think of cyst, but when put in color, there is flow inside, making it a tumor. And there is a cyst in the tail of pancreas. When put on color, there is flow that indicates aneurysm of the splenic artery. Now here there is a mass in the liver in a newborn. There is dilated hepatic vein and the portal vein, indicating that it is a hemangioendothelium of the liver. Now some maneuvers can characterize the mass. Here you see a mass in a patient with hematuria, whether it is a mass or a clot, you change the position of the patient, shift so it is clot. Now here in a woman with a lower abdominal mass, there is this solid mass anteriorly. With shift of position, it also shifts, indicated only mass which can float on fluid is fat. So this is fat. That brings us to a diagnosis of cystic teratoma. You see the shift in real time. Now, characteristics may be useful if you know the age, history, and echo pattern. Now, this is a child with urinary bladder. You see a mass inside, and with a change in position, it shifts, so you diagnose calculus. But the history is ureteric reimplantation done 3 months back. So within 3 months, you cannot get such a big calculus. So that brings us to a diagnosis of foreign body left over in the urinary bladder. This is a cyst in the pancreas with a history of acute pancreatitis, so it is pseudocyst. And once you are diagnosed malignant mass, you have to look for extension. Now, this is renal carcinoma, the breach of the perinephric fat line, perinephric infiltration. And when there is no perinephric infiltration, the mass moves well with respiration. Whereas here, you see that the liver moves, but the kidney is fixed, indicating that there is perinephric infiltration. Renal cell carcinoma, there is infiltration and thrombosis of the renal vein, no flow on color Doppler, and extends into the IVC also. So by this, you know the extension. Here, again, a renal cell carcinoma extending into the renal pelvis, along the ureter, up to the bladder. And again, renal cell carcinoma with a distant hepatic metastasis. Now, a case of hepatocellular carcinoma infiltrating the portal vein with thrombosis and a metastatic lymph node in the porta hepatis. And a lymphoma with involving the bowel as well as lymph nodes. And we come to the complications of mass. Now, this is a renal cell carcinoma with hemorrhage. You see the perinephric hematoma. And this is a hepatocellular carcinoma on the surface, which has bled with a local hematoma. And this is an angiomyolipoma, which has bled with a retroperitoneal hematoma. Now, this is a woman with distension of abdomen and pain. You see ascites. And in the lower abdomen, you see this collapsed ovarian cyst. So this is ovarian cyst, which is ruptured. And this is a renal liver abscess, which is ruptured with ascites and hemoperitoneum. This is a hemoperitoneum with a clot, and you see a splenic artery aneurysm, which has leaked. And complicate, now this is a case of pained abdomen and vomiting. There is a mesenteric cyst as evidenced by a bowel loop inside, but patient has presented with acute pain. So that is not explained by this diagnosis. But you see this area, so a close look shows that there is pneumoperitoneum and ascites. So what has happened is, look a little more medial to that, you see the whirlpool sign indicating that the mesenteric cyst has resulted in volvulus producing the perforation of bowel. Now this is a child with ovarian cyst and with hairs indicating cystic teratoma. But the patient has presented with acute pain and vomiting. So you have to look for any complication and you see this area with high frequency, that shows the snail shell sign of whirlpool sign. And in real time, you see the whirlpool sign indicating that it is a ovarian cyst torsion. Ultrasound is also useful in follow-up after surgery for malignancy. This is a case of carcinoma of left kidney, and follow-up shows local recurrence, and it can be lymph node metastasis, or it can be recurrence at the ureterovesical junction, or there may be recurrent tumor thrombus in the IVC. So to stress the role of ultrasound in a mass, I'll show this example as the concluding case. This is a 4-year-old boy with pain in the left flank for 15 days. His earlier ultrasound has been reported as hydatid cyst, which is unusual for a 4-year-old. And CT scan was reported as large perirenal complex cystic mass with a few mildly enlarged parietic lymph nodes. So mesenchymal malignancy has to be ruled out. This is the coronal scan, transverse scan. You see a large cystic mass in, and the kidney is compressed here. So whether it is renal or extrarenal, this is the real time showing that the mass moves with the kidney. So maybe arising from the kidney or infiltrating. High frequency transverse scan of upper pole shows the beak sign, showing that the mass is arising from the kidney. A sagittal scan shows the reverse beak sign. So it may be misleading sometimes. And there are solid areas showing that it is a tumor. And on high frequency, I mean, color shows flow within the septa, showing that it is not a hydatid cyst. And it shows low resistance flow, making it more malignancy. And high frequency show medial to the mass shows an enlarged metastatic lymph node. So the final diagnosis is Wilms tumor with lymph node metastasis. So this is how the various modification of your technique and various signs will help to arrive at a final diagnosis in an abdominal mass. Thank you very much for your patient listening.